My name is Eng Leong, and I'm from Malacca. I'd like to thank all of you for coming to this sharing session. I will say that this is a sharing session. And thank you so much to Fong San Si for actually hosting this event. And also to my friend Che Tiong, my temple friend in KL, who actually invited me to come over in Singapore. And my talk today is about cultural insights of a Chinese Peranakan family in Malacca. And before I start on, I would like to stress a few things, among others, that because this is just a 1 hour sharing session, I will not be able to speak at length all the details. And what I've done is that I've shown in pictures so that as I go along, I will actually try my best to explain certain aspects of the things. And secondly, some of the things may not be in pictures. So I will try to talk about what I experienced as a child, when I was growing up, and what is still being practiced in the family. And another aspect is that some of the things which I described may no longer be practiced in my family. And my talk today will come in two parts. The first part will be about Chinese culture, festivals which are being practiced in my family. And the second part will be about the rites of passage, talking about birth and death, and talking about events which we all look forward for, weddings and also birthdays, grand birthday celebrations. Okay? So without much ado, please go to the next slide. Well, I would like to dedicate this talk, this sharing, to a great man, and he's no other than my late grandfather, Mr. Lim Eng San. This year actually marks his 25th anniversary of his death. He passed away in 1988, but I think my grandfather actually impacted a lot on my life, in the sense that I was very close to my grandfather. He's a very knowledgeable man. He knows a lot of things about the adat, and of course he married to my grandmother, a very typical Nyonya. Yeah. Yeah, I think the pictures. Okay, my grandfather was actually the state treasurer of Malacca during the British time. And in those days, it's quite common for a groom to stay in their wife's place. Yeah? So this is actually the house in Malacca, 8 Depot Road. And this is my grandma, and this my grandma's sister, my grandma's brother, and another of my grandma's brother. Okay, they are from the Yeo family, and this is located in 8 Depot Road in Malacca. The house has been leveled down, it's no more there. Yeah? So this picture was probably taken some way back in the early 1940s, late 1940s or early 1950s. Yeah? Can I have the next slide, please? And this picture was taken some way back in 1930s. Yeah. I can, because my father over here was just a little boy, so my father was born in 1931. So I can imagine that this took place about 1937, 38. Yeah. Next slide. And this is where my house is located. 8 Depot Road was located here. Then later on, my grandfather built his house. This house is still standing in Malacca, 10 Depot Road. Nowadays, it's very lonely because my house is the only one standing in Malacca. In this street, we used to have many neighbors by the side, in front, at the back. Yeah. But now we are very lonely. Yeah. And with this background, I will move on to the next section. Okay, first, I will describe Tang Che. Tang Che is actually winter solstice, celebrated either 21st or 22nd of December. And why I start Tang Che? Simply because During Tang Chek, it's the last festival at the end of the year. In fact, it marks Thanksgiving. This is where in olden day China, after the harvest, there'll be a celebration, there'll be a big dinner, you know. And in my family, we used to have ancestral worship. And as ancestral worship, we would have a big ancestral worship with all the lao. We have 8 bowls of food, and we have something, you know. And most importantly, we would have the kui yin. I think you all know what is kui yin. It's ground dumplings, red and white. Yeah, this will be very significant and be offered to the household deities. It will also be offered to the ancestors. Yeah. And as a child, the night before, I remember vividly my aunt and my mom, they were actually doing the kui yin. And it was a challenge for us youngsters, because all of us were challenged one another to make the roundest of the kui yin, the red and white. Yeah. And the next day, of course, we start off by offering to the deities, first the household deities, then after which we will pray to the ancestors. One significant thing which I remember as a child, I always look forward to one thing, and that would be to take the kui yin and actually place it on the doors. Yeah, I think some families still practice, but a lot of them don't practice anymore. And why do we do that? Simply because it was believed that by putting the kui yin at the door, it will actually dispel evil, you know. And Tang Chek also is very significant, because after Tang Chek, a lot of things will start moving, because the next main festival will be Chinese New Year. Yeah? And I will remember vividly, very vividly, because after Tang Chek, there will be bamboo leaves sent to my house, and what we'll do is that we will fix it over into bamboo, yeah? Fix it, tie it, and what we will do is that we will sapu laba-laba. Okay, sapu laba-laba means we will actually, you know, this roof, sometimes you have cobwebs and all that. We will take one whole day to actually clean the whole household, yeah? And after that, we have to sweep the floor. The next thing we do is to sweep the floor, to clean the floor. In fact, in those days, we use water, we use soap, brush, we will scrub the floor, yeah? And I remember, I was told that during the early days, we even polished the floors. In fact, we have this sort of flooring. We will polish it into very shiny. Yeah? But of course, it doesn't work anymore. You know, it involves a lot of work, you know, during those days. So the next thing will, of course, be Chinese New Year and Sembahyang Tikong. I will leave this to later, because I have pictures and I'll describe further on that. And Qingming happens about 1.5 months after Chinese New Year. Basically, what we do is that during this time, we will visit the graves. Yeah, the graves, my family graves all are located somewhere in, somewhere in Batu Prenang, that's right. Yeah, there's a very big Chinese grave here. And I have, in fact, 7 graves to visit. And to tell you the truth, I dread going to the Qingming, visiting the tombs, simply because there'll be so many people, and in the morning, you go early, you start off early, then after that, you end up about noon, 7 graves, and it's all packed. And after that, there will be, after, on the exact day of Qingming, we again have ancestral worship, okay? And after that, we will have a dumpling festival. Can we have of course, Kui Chang, I think all of you know what Kui Chang is. Kui Chang, of course, I will remember vividly my mother makes one of the best Kui Chang that I know. In fact, I couldn't find anyone makes better than my mother, you know. And I remember she will get up something like 5 o'clock in the morning over a period of 2 days. And it's a lot of work, simply because these bamboo leaves will have to be soaked. And my mother actually really cleaned all the leaves one by one, clean it, and after that dry it, you know. And of course, this is a big no. Because we will use the strings which are made from fiber. And my mother's kway chang, you can't even see the rice grains. It's so mampat, you know. It's so, and it's really nice. And the ingredients that she used tang kway, she used sesame seeds, you know. I think her nyonya chang is really good. I tried to learn, but of course, those days, I was pretty young. And my mother would say, if you want to make this kway chang, please go out there, take the passe and go and do it. After that, you come and see me. Of course, I didn't take the challenge, you know. But the dumpling festival, one of the unique things that you will find is that this leaf, you know, this leaf believed to actually ward off evil spirits. In fact, this leaf, you put this leaf in all the doors of your household, okay? I will admit, over this part, my uncle actually forgot to put the red paper. You know, there's supposed to be red paper wrapped over the leaves. Yeah. And another thing I will remember vividly, nowadays if I go back to Malacca and it happens to be that festival, I will try my best to practice. But other than that, I will not remind again my uncle because he's old. What we'll do at 12 o'clock, after we have already did all the offerings of kway chang, there will be a bowl of wine at the altar, and it's mixed with sulfur. Okay? Yeah. And what do we do after that? We will actually sprinkle it around the house and at the compound. Okay, why? Okay, it was later explained, I found out that actually snakes, they are afraid of sulfur. You know, in the olden days, of course, you have compound, we have a kampong behind, there are snakes. In fact, it's true. My father almost stepped on a cobra at the doorstep. And this is the festival where we actually sprinkle those sulfur and also the wine. Okay? Next one, of course, is Bulan Tujuh. My grandfather, along with his brother-in-laws, as I mentioned just now, they were all trustees to land which is next to my household. Yeah. And that land, all those houses, they used to pay rent, you know, rental. And during Bulan Tujuh, actually what happens is that we invite the cook to cook. They will cook all the nyonya dishes, and overnight, at night when they simbai Bulan Tujuh, they will come and pray the respects to the hungry ghost, and then they will also have a meal or two. But of course, this practice, the last time I think it was practiced was probably in early 1980s. I was a small boy then. Of course, I was afraid because they always say it's a sembahyang hantu. So, yeah, I would never, even my side door where the sembahyang, you can actually see, we will close it, and I will always have a peep. Yeah. And of course, the next one I will talk about is the day-to-day practices of Peranakan. What my family does in the morning, actually, we will offer joss sticks first to the tengkong, then to the household deity. Then at the back, we have the datuk dapo. Yeah. So we will, for tengkong, we will actually offer our joss sticks above our head. Then for the household deities, we will just this manner because that the ranking of the Jin Emperor is the highest. Yeah? And of course, during the first and 15th, you'll find offerings such as flowers and also fruits. Yeah? Another thing I could remember was that on every Thursday night, there will be my auntie will actually ask up the rumor with the menyan. Okay, as you know, on Thursday nights to the Malays, it's called Malam Jumaat. Yeah? So we will actually ask up the whole house with this menyan. But of course, this again is no more practice. I remembered my aunt, she could actually recite some Malay baca baca, you know. So as a child, if I the mom, if I'm having a fever or so, I will sit down there and she will take the incense with the communion and she will just do her prayers. The prayers are all in Malay, and I remember she will just take the asap and asap my whole body. And surprisingly, I actually recovered, you know. And sometimes she will just use the water, she will just baca baca, and then after that she will drink the manyan, then after that she will let me drink the water. Yeah. So these are some of the practices. And then, of course, we have, like sometimes we have the household deities, the birthday or the household deities. What we will do, we will offer miswa in our bowl and gula batu, and of course we offer some flowers, we will burn joss papers. So that's what I remember. And my house happens to be on the main road, and whenever the procession passes by, like in this case, Vesak Day, so we will put offerings such as this. This practice, many years ago, is still being practiced. Households will actually have offerings outside their house, but I noticed that it is dying off nowadays. Any processions, yeah? And for the eight moon, I remember, nowadays it's no more being practiced, but I remember when my grandmother was alive, apart from offering moon cakes to the household deities and also to the ancestors, at night she would pray. There will be moon cakes, there will be flowers, sweet smelling flowers like bunga sukunungan, and then jasmine, St. Joseph. There will also be, you know, powder. In the olden days, they used the block powder, it's in square, and then we will offer scented perfume to the moon goddess, yeah? And we, of course, will burn joss paper. But, of course, this is no longer being practiced. And now, we go to Chinese New Year. Chinese New Year is something which my family really look forward to. I remember when I was a kid, a few days before Chinese New Year, it's the balas time, I would call it, simply because close friends, relatives will actually send things such as live hen, live duck, you know. They were sending even crates of aerated drinks. They were sending goodies such as cakes, and they were sent to the house, and we are expected to return other things. Yeah, they were sending oranges, all the Chinese New Year goodies like lap chiang, the Chinese sausages, and from there we will actually exchange. Yeah, and prior to that, of course, my mother will be very busy because she will be doing the ampe ampe. Ampe ampe is actually the papaya, the dried papaya that you stuff into the chili. Yeah, she used to make achar chili and sell. And my father is the person who goes to the market with his bicycle. He buy all the chilies in kilos and the cucumber, dry them off. Yeah. And over a period of maybe on a weekend, all of us will gotong royong. To do what? To make tarts. Yeah. At one go, I remember that we have like something like 15 pineapples. And in those days, we don't have blender. We have a parut, you know. So we have to parut those pineapple tarts, jam, to make the jam. And after that, the jam, you have to stir it over a grain sink. It's a grain sink, then you have to make the jam first. Then after that, all of us, we will make the side of these tarts, and then we put the hinge into the tarts. And also we make a lot of cakes, and it's a very busy time. And of course, a week before Chinese New Year, prior to that, we have Datuk Zain, sorry, not this slide, I remember Datuk Nai is actually, that's the day when all the household deities were actually leave for heaven, yeah. So we will pray to the household gods and also the kitchen god. And we will offer actually a chicken, wine, oranges, and also kueh bako to the household deities. Then of course Chinese New Year, the eve of Chinese New Year is a very busy time. Before we pray to the ancestors, it is very important that we need to pray to the household deities first. And after that, we have another unique feature. We pray to the Semangat Rumah. Okay, what is the Semangat Rumah? Semangat Rumah is actually the guardians of the household, okay? The guardians of the household. It's an act of thanksgiving. We will in fact offer a bowl of rice at the side hall and a bowl of food, and we will offer candles and joystick, and we will burn joss paper. Yeah. Then only after doing that can we pray to our ancestors. In my household, what we do, we chia abu. Chia abu means you invite your ancestors back to your house. In some households, they have piara abu, which means to say that their ancestral tablets are in the house. Yeah. So my house practice chia abu. So the day before, we will actually invite our ancestors. In my case, because my ancestral tablets are placed in Sekiani, I will actually go to Sekiani on behalf of the family to offer joysticks, inform my grandfather, my grandmother, my mother and all that, my aunties that we are having sembahyang, please come home. And as a formality at home, I will do again at a site, yeah? At the site, and I will invite my ancestors. The altar will be set up, there will be chairs placed at the altar table. So, in the morning, this is what is being offered. We have eight bowls of food being offered. Eight because it is believed that Rame, there's many of your relatives who comes back. So that's why we offer eight bowls of food. The first row, over here, we call it Lao Besar. Lao Besar means you have pongteh, and on top of it, we have the whole chicken. Over here, we have samchan. Actually, at the top of it, we make it into a cube. Yeah. Over here, we have chap chai, and we have kaki babi. And the next four bowls, it can be anything else. Maybe we have curries. In this case, we have masak lemak. Over here, we have steak bar. Here we have tea. And here again, we have chap chai. Yeah? And then, of course, we have some seng. In my house, we have... in those days, we used to boil our own pork. Yeah? And nowadays, for simplicity, I just go and buy the roasted pork. Yeah? But in those days, you have karat. Your babi has to be like in karat of four. The bones have to be in karat of four, eight or 12. Yeah? And then, of course, you will have a whole duck. In replacement of a duck, we have cuttlefish, we have meat, and also we have duck egg. And of course, a chicken. Next slide, please. So this is another view, and of course we will have some lauk piring. Of course we have condiments like acar chili, we have the sausage, and then some lepak kacang and pejicho. Yeah. These are all Malay cakes actually. And these are some of the offerings that we offer to our ancestors. You see, most of these offerings are being offered normally during Cheng Meng and also Bulan Tujuh. But in this case, because if you notice, we offer clothes. Because it's Chinese New Year, so you want to offer new clothes to your ancestors as well. And this Kertas Emas, normally to the deities, we will have, it will be folded upper and also lower into like a floral shape. But because we are praying to our ancestors, it's only the lower part. Yeah? course, we will have the joss paper in gold and also silver. And the gold paper, in fact, you have to burn it first. I remember why this is being done. My elders used to tell me that you burn the gold paper, in fact, it's for the topical, the guardians. So that those gold paper are for the guardians, and followed by the silver paper for your ancestors. Okay? And Sambut Kepala Tahun. Sambut Kepala Tahun is actually ushering of the Chinese New Year. At night after we have our family reunion, then we will pray to usher in the Chinese New Year. Those days, ushering of New Year normally is being carried out in the early hours of the day, early morning, maybe about 5, 6 o'clock. But it's a bit, some family actually practice it late at night. Yeah? But my family used to practice early in the morning. Yeah, but nowadays for simplicity and also for convenience sake, after our Chinese New Year reunion, we were actually ushering the New Year by having this offering. Very important offerings will be kueh bakul. Yeah, on top of the kueh bakul, there will be huat kueh over here. You can see, and then over on the sides, you will have nasi, where you have the isora and also a spring onion to represent the arrival of spring. Another offering would be anak sawi with water, and this actually represents blessings of the year to the family. These three offerings are very, very important, and it's only being done during the Chinese New Year. Of course, you have tebu and pisang, is important. Next slide, please. And of course, you have teh liao. Everything that you offer during the New Year, it has to be sweet. Yeah. Of course, this is a new addition because nowadays my family group together, and once a year we actually do chanting and all that. Yeah. And of course, the Sambut Kepala Tahun officially will be done by meal. Then after that, other family members will follow suit. Yeah. This is a tradition my family has. Everyone will actually offer just this. And of course, Chinese New Year, the lion dance. We will invite the lion dance. And of course, we will have burning of crackers. Yeah. Of course, it's illegal. The lion dance will go all over to the house and also even to the dato-tapu. Yeah, this chimney, I remember this chimney. We used to have rubber wood. I remember the rubber wood cutter would come and I will actually arrange all the rubber wood and place it over there. Yeah, in the olden days. And during Chinese New Year spring cleaning, I will remember my father. In fact, I remember he's the only one who does this. He will take the bamboo. Because it's a chimney, he will go up there and jolo, you know. He will actually clean up there. Then after that, all the dust and you all be black, you know. Then I will run away from my father. Yeah. So that's how, shortly, how we celebrate Chinese New Year. Of course, on the 8th day of Chinese New Year is Sembayang Tikong. Sembayang Tikong is very much anticipated by the family. In fact, this is the highlight of the year's event. Sembayang Tikong actually represents a way to, as a thanksgiving to the Jade Emperor. Of course, you will know some of the legends with regard to the Sembayang Tikong. Of course, we have the Tok Sam Kan. And of course, this is a picture taken, I think, about 30 years ago, and that's me. I always remember Sembayang Tikong because that's the time I get to play fireworks, the sparklers, the fountains. Yeah. And this is the altar part of the Tok Sam Kan, and this is the Chana. Yeah. The Tok Sam Kan is actually a three-layered table. Of course, you have the lower, the upper, and I believe this is the third layer, the China. It is actually made of papaya and cherry. In fact, my grandmother, she used to make this in the, she will always do this at night. It's very intricate. And but after she has passed on, yeah, no one in my family knows how to do it. In fact, what we'll do is that we will have a simpler version of pineapple and also red dates. Yeah, and this is actually made by one of my friends to keep up with the tradition. So we started doing this a few years back with the help of my friend, of course. And this is on the other side of the samkai. You'll find very important. This is the palita. My family calls it group. I don't know why, but we call it group. It is very important. This light, apart from the candles, this light has very significant meaning. It should be lighted all the time. Yeah. And of course, we have miswa, and then we will have bumerampe and fruits on top of it. And this is a side view of it. These are oranges. My family uses nine oranges. Some family uses six. Yeah. Apart from Sembahyang Tikung, during Chinese New Year, we also offer this. And this bowl of oranges actually, I believe, it represents a mountain of gold. Yeah. On the bowl, you are actually place some rice, uncooked rice. Yeah? And on the lower table, you will find mangkok, yeah? With offerings of a vegetarian. We will actually use the mangkok and we'll arrange. It's a very tedious task. Yeah? And this is a hua kintok. This is only found in Malacca. Yeah? Found in Malacca, special buns made of flour. It's actually tasteless, yeah. It's red and white. Red for luck, white for purity. And it comes in various shapes, like round and in the shape of a chicken. Yeah. And we'll offer 12 bowls of it. And we can put a lot of vegetarian stuff. Yeah. I have another view, and of course this is another kueh called kueh kemoha, and also is significant in Malacca. Again, this is another important offering, huat kueh, and this is another variation of huat kueh, but it's made from rice flour. The Peranakans actually like to use this sort of huat kueh, and we have angku. And then we will have kueh pitis and kueh in. Actually, the angku we have in various forms. This is the turtle shape. The kueh pitis is actually comes from a mold, like old Chinese coins. Yeah? And of course, the round ones are like kueh in. Another very important offering is the bananas and also the sugar cane. The bananas, the variety of the bananas are Pisang Raja, yeah, and sugar canes. My family actually shred off the skin and half it. Yeah. Some family they just put it whole, yeah, whole sugar canes. And this is my candles. And in fact, this is my own creation. Actually, I put flowers on top of the candles. Yeah. And that's the other side of my main altar. My house, actually, part of my house was overtaken by the government the land of it was overtaken, so it actually affected my first born. So you find that the table for Sungai Tikong and my main water is shortened. Yeah? We used to have a lot of space where we can actually kneel down in front of both waters, but because my hall is shorter, we find that it's very cramped up. Yeah. Before the slide, just now we have joss papers. This is the Ketas mask, the lower joss paper. We also have the Tikong King, which is the larger joss paper, which we will also fold. And of course, after the sembahyang, we will burn outside the house. Of course, with some crackers, although it's illegal, but if nothing happens, the police will not come to disturb me. So that sums up how the sembahyang now the rites of passage. The birth. What happens after a baby is born, especially if it's a grandson? Yeah. The 1 month celebrations, of course, Angku Kueh will be offered to the, and also eggs will be offered to the household deities. Yeah. And also this angku and also eggs will be given to close relatives. In my family, we also do another type of glutinous rice. We call it upeng. Yeah. And during these days, we will go to the house of our relatives in the Pakosia. We will send it to our relatives. And in return, what they will do is that in our Pakosia, they will place rice. And they will place an angpao. And some close families, they will even give some jewelry for the baby. Yeah? And also, for 1 month old, the baby will actually be shaved clean. Yeah, because they believe that from the mother's womb is dirty, so you have to make the baby pure. Yeah? And I remember, the baby is not supposed to touch the floor for 1 year, after the baby is 1 year. Yeah. And once the baby is 1 year, I remember my cousin, we have a very funny practice. The baby will be placed in front of the door with a kuih bong. You know what is a kuih bong? Kuih bong is a drumsticks, with a pair of drumsticks, with the hope that the baby will grow up as a child, could walk properly, and it would actually, basically will be in perfect shape. Yeah. Then, of course, this is no longer in practice anymore. Yeah. Yeah, for death, of course, death comes very unexpectedly. Yeah. This picture shows the funeral of my late grandfather way back in 1980. So you'll find that's me. I was pretty young, and of course, we were using the baju blacu. Yeah, and you see, nowadays funerals, you cannot identify who is who. Yeah, but during those days, we used to wear all this. But once you look at this, you will know that this is Poha Besar. That means you are the immediate. Yeah, and these are all the married to the girl side. Yeah. So that's why over here, some of them, they are wearing the blue and the red. So from here, you can actually identify how these people are actually related to the family, to the deceased. Yeah. And this is the quanta. For you can identify from the quanta at the top over here. If it's a lion, it means it's a male. If it's a crane, it means that it's a female. Yeah. And of course, this is the night visit. We did some chanting the night before the funeral. And you see the cross. Okay, why is cross? It means both grandfather and grandmother have passed on. If it's only the main site, then part of it will be only one part of the white paper will be on the building. And this is, of course, the Golden Day Coffin. And over here, just before the procession, again, through rank, the relatives will actually come and they offer a wine to the deceased. Yeah? And there will be ceremony over here. You can see I'm not playing drums. It's actually part of the ceremony band playing the music. Now we come to wedding. This is actually the wedding of my grandparents. I think this took place in 1926, February 1926. You will notice that the garment worn by my grandfather is actually a Manchu type of garb. The head's conical. Yeah. And there's a difference between my grandfather's costume and also my father. This took place in 1957. And this picture, you will notice that there are two lanterns. This actually denotes one thing, that because my mother is from KL actually, and she's from the Tan family. And both weddings are being taken place in one house. So in a wedding, when you find only one lantern, then you know that the wedding will take place in the house of the groom and also the bride. In this case, the whole ceremony is being held in one house. So you will have the lanterns, two lanterns. And also at the altar, you'll find that there will be two sets of candles. One, the dragon, and also the other, the phoenix dragon. To denote that both weddings are being held the same household. Yeah, this picture actually came one day when my house was infected by white ants, and my brother actually kemas rumah and he wanted to clear everything. He thought that this was a funeral. But when I saw this picture, I quickly kept it. Actually, it's not a funeral. This, you can see orang, I think we call it Boyan. Okay, in their costumes, they were carrying the lanterns and also the chaiki. In fact, they were bearing 12 trays of gifts for the family. Yeah. And over here, you can see, this is a congratulatory board which was presented to my grandfather. Because my grandfather was a chairman to a temple in Malacca. And this procession actually took place about 100 meters from my house, and they actually sent it over to my house. Yeah. And you can see over here, my grandfather stood over here, and these are all my uncles, senior members of the family. They were receiving the congratulatory board. And if you notice in this picture, you can only see the men folk. Where are the female? They are all in the house hiding somewhere. And while that took place, there was a Saruni band playing over here. Yeah. And they will always be positioned on this side with a table, simply because they will look at the proceedings of the day, what is taking place, because if they see that the Pasang Lining ceremony was being held, then they will play a different tempo. Have you all heard what a Saruni band sounds like? I think some of you may have. Just an example how it will sound like. It is, I find it very scary, very screeching. Yeah. It sounded like this. And the band actually consists of Saruni Basar, clarinet, and also tambol, some cymbals, and some just like that. And this band will actually play when some of the ceremonies are being carried out, and this is of course the Chotao ceremony. Both bride and also both groom will have to undergo this ceremony. This is actually the purification ceremony. The Baju Chotao is all in white to signify purity. And in fact, to cut off the Baju Chotao, there is a ceremony. They will bilih hari. They will check with the jomensis what is the best day to actually cut the Baju Chotao. And the Chotao ceremony is very important in Peranakan wedding. Yeah. The bride will always face the Samkai altar because the females are always considered as more pure than men. So they could actually face heaven. But the men are not so, are always more naughty. So they face inwards towards the altar. They will actually sit on the gantang, and there will be objects will actually be placed in this purification ceremony. In this case, the book of divinity will actually be placed on the bride. Yeah. And of course, the hair to make the sangod for the wedding. And of course, this is the chotao for my father. And this is how my parents look like. And over this side, you will find that it is the Siri Dara. Nowadays, I hardly, in fact, I don't see anymore. The Siri Dara actually, it has a very important significance because it signifies the purity of the bride. Yeah? The Siri Dara actually consists of Siri, and it is artfully done. Yeah, and it's been placed at the altar. And this is a very important ceremony simply because before the groom actually leaves the house to fetch the bride, he will pay respects to all the elders. Yeah, in this case, my grandfather is being will actually offer wine to my father, and in a way, it actually represents blessing for you. Please go ahead. You are not now a man. You are on your own. Yeah. Basically, it's blessings to the groom. Please, it's a new life for you. Yeah. Okay. Next. And of course, with the saroni playing, it can be very touching. In fact, for the bride, because it means that bride will be leaving the family and will be starting a new life. Yeah. And in this case, you can see to the strings of the saroni band, it's a very solemn ceremony, and she pays respect to the elders. Some of them shed tears. I think this is legendary. It has been written about. And of course, I mentioned about the Siri Dara. In this case, my mother will actually place my mother actually placed the top part of the Siri Dara on the altar. And because the wedding took place in one household, the bride and the groom actually met each other at a hall, not in the bedroom. Yeah? And of course, this is the last slide. My parents' wedding were actually quite modern. It took place in 1957, so we do not have all those things like the ranjang lomsan. We were very modern. In fact, after the wedding, my parents changed to modern costume. Yeah, and even my parents' bridal chamber was quite simple. Yeah. And that marks my whole presentation for today. Please, if you have any questions, please ask. Oh yeah, I have birthday. Yeah. Yeah, of course, birthdays are very much celebrated, especially if you are 80 years old. And I'll just show you some pictures of my father's birthday, which was held about 2 years ago. Of course, this is again a setup of the family altar, a simpler one. And of course, this is the pasang lilin. We had a small ceremony where my father actually gave thanksgiving. He lighted the candles, long candles, and he offered joysticks. And after which, I offered miswa to my father. In fact, this is supposed to be performed by the elder son, but because my brother was actually quite busy on that day, he's working, he couldn't make it on time. So I actually represented my brother. Yeah, and during birthday celebrations, of course, after I offer the miswa, other family members will offer tea to my father. In fact, this is the method how we will greet our elders during Chinese New Year as well. We will kneel down. Of course, we will say panjang panjang umur, wishing you long life, you know. And my father's brother and also some other relatives, they offered lilin candles to represent long life. There will be miswa also to represent long life. There will be gula batu to represent sweetness in life, and also eggs. Yeah. So you could imagine the number of relatives coming over your house, and all the gifts are all about the same: eggs and miswa and gula batu, all the same gifts, you know. So what we'll do after that, the eggs probably you make serikaya. Yeah. And of course, the birthday boy will give angpao to you. Yeah. And of course, this is a family portrait. And of course, there's makan. Well, this is a very simple setup. Nowadays, it's all buffet style. Nowadays, you won't find family cooking. So we, of course, cater. This is a very simple lunch. Yeah. But in those days, when the women folk, there were many women folk, they would actually cook in the kitchen. Sometimes we would invite a chompo, a cook, a Hainanese cook, to actually cook for the whole family. Of course, just to show that in those olden days, when we have a lot of manpower, we will sit down in this meja panjang. Yeah? And in fact, this is one of the birthday celebrations. Can you guess whose birthday was this? Actually, it was my birthday, and I had the honor to sit beside my grandfather. Yeah, that's me. I think I was about 3 or 4 years old. Yeah. And when I found this picture, in fact, I was quite touched because many of these people are no longer there. Yeah, they actually they impacted on my life. Yeah. So doing this presentation actually brought me back to all the good memories of my past. And of course, at night, we Peranakans, we like to joget. As I think you all know, this is how we joget and some line dancing, and this is how my family looks like. So thank you. Thank you so much for being here. If you have any questions, please, I will try my best to answer. Yes, please.
Is it difficult now to get all the things you need to keep up the ceremonies where you live?
Yes. In fact, it is difficult. In a sense that, like for Chinese New Year, an example, yeah. You know, sugar cane is actually quite, you know, it used to be abundant. Everywhere you get sugar cane. But sugar cane is a very important, it has a lot of significance. So I'm like a crazy fool. During Chinese New Year, everybody is busy. I'll be going around looking for sugar cane. Yeah? First, to place on the altar. And my family actually placed sugar cane on the door during Chinese New Year. Apart from sembahyang tikul, we also place sugar cane. And I refuse to actually stop it, because I know once I stop it, then future generations will forget about it. So I remember vividly. In fact, my cousin's sister actually was the one who started doing it, and because my grandmother used to do it. And I remember as a child, and I relive this. And it's difficult to find things like gula batu, sugar cane, even in Malacca. What we are experiencing in Malacca nowadays, many families don't live in their ancestral house anymore. We are experiencing what Singapore used to experience maybe way back in the 1960s, 1970s. It's quite tedious even for ancestral worship. So it happened that my family have some of these stuff, and we still have it. It's a family thing, so we actually place it, and I'm the so-called guardian. I know where all these things are being placed, and I will pick it up. Yeah, I'm the one that my uncles sometimes will also refer to me. Yeah. And some of the things is difficult to come by. So what happens is that sometimes I will just find something and I will just buy it. Yeah.
Like the kue-kue, not everybody makes the kue-kue nowadays, right?
In fact, we buy it.
I have to buy my... Yeah.
In Malacca, there's one particular shop that sells the wok kentok. And this shop caters a lot to the Malaccans. It's located in Tegera.
Then long time ago, I remember that, on Pachik Day, there's a belief that if it rains on that day, on New Year, it will rain or not rain. Do you remember?
Yes.
You know, we used to observe that.
Yes.
What's
the
relation like?
It's just a belief. If Tang Che, it rains, Chinese New Year, it will rain.
Okay, so it's not the opposite, so it's the same thing.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. That's how I remember.
And it seems, well,
with
the observation, generally it's true as kids, paying attention to it.
Any more questions? Yes, please.
The sugar cane, is it particular to Baba or Hokkien itself?
It's in particular, particular to Hokkien and also the Baba thing, simply because most of the Babas are Hokkien. Yeah. So sugar cane is very important. Of course, the legend says that at one time during a long time ago, the Hokkien actually during the heat in the sugarcane farm, yeah. So on the 9th day, they came up, yeah. So that's why the place.
Are there any dishes that cannot be served during auspicious days?
Yes.
Like Hong Tei, they say cannot be served during birthdays and Kui Ko Chi or...
Correct. True. Hong Tei, Chi Hi, all these are not being served during happy occasions. In fact, even cakes, certain cakes are not being served during happy occasions. Okay, your question about kuih kochi, okay, do you know what is a kochi?
The paper.
Correct. Kochi is actually kochi is actually a paper, joss paper, a very special type of paper, which is an offering that is being given to the deceased. In fact, when the coffin is being prepared, I remember very, very vividly, even for my mother's funeral, the caretaker will actually ask everyone, who wants to offer kochi to the deceased. In fact, it's blocks of joss paper, then it will be placed on the casket. Yeah. And me being the grandson, I was given the honors because my elder brother was not present, so I was given the honors to nail my grandfather's coffin. Kuih kochi, it represents that, so that's why it's being offered to the ancestors only during Cheng Beng and Cheng Beng Bulan Tujuh, but never ever served that during wedding. Even Pong Tei, not offered during weddings. Weddings, we have special food.
Oh,
what is that?
Stangi.
Ah, yeah, Stangi.
And is there anybody who can still make the Stangi?
Yeah. But you know, Stangi, the fragrance of the Stangi, it is so sweet smelling, you know, that I always look forward to it. Because during the early morning when it's Sambuk Kepala Tahun, one of the things that you after Sambuk, you will have this Stangi burning on the charcoal, you know. It's so fragrant, you know. Along with the Bunga Rampai, I tell you, you can't describe it. But unfortunately, nowadays, you can't find Stangi. In fact, I'm trying to find people who actually knows how to do Stangi. Yeah. I remember an Indian Baba will actually come over to my house and sell it, and we will buy packets of it. Yeah. Stangi is actually a concoction of fragrance from sandalwood and sugar, oil, fragrance, a few herbs. It's very nice smelling.
Can I ask you a question? It's been documented that at Cheng Hung Ting Temple on the last day of Chinese New Year, it is closed, it's open only to Peranakan. And on this day, nasi kumis is offered. Is it still being carried out?
Not to my knowledge. I think nowadays, that probably happens because during those days there used to be a lot of Peranakans. But now the temple, from my observation, is open. And I don't see any nasi kunyit being offered. But I do know of families with ancestral altars, with their tablets on Chak Gomi, they offer glutinous rice and also pengat pisang to their ancestors. I do remember that. Yeah. But it's not being practiced by my family. So for food during weddings, okay, we will have kueh teh tarts, we will have kueh pai tee, top heads, we will have kueh genggang, red color. For funeral, the kueh genggang, there's a variation. Instead of that red color, you will have blue. This is how we adapt. Yeah.
How many layers are kueh genggang? Because some people use 7, some 9, and usually I see 8.
I believe I actually don't count, but what I know is that I will pick it layer by layer as a child, and I still not there.
Usually, when I was small, I used to put a red dot on the soil basket. Is it still, why is it being done?
Okay.
And some people say even kueh apam was put a red dot.
Okay, why the red is significant? Simply because the cakes are white, right? So you need to put a red. Denote good luck, you know. Yeah. Even like our offerings during the Boa Kek Tok, the Mangkok Kek, yeah. If some of those offerings like black mushroom, the pak choy, is all black. So what we'll do is that we have something red. Yeah. So even like the white tau fu, right, it's white color. So we will have something red. Because red is the auspicious color. So any more questions? I will try my best to answer.
You think after this, probably Hong Kong is not being served, right?
Yeah.
Yes. So what is the reason for it?
Okay. Bobby Pong Tei is actually being served during ancestral offerings and also during funerals. Yeah. So for simply because it's being offered to the ancestors, So it's a happy occasion. We have food for a happy occasion. Yeah. In fact, many people didn't know. So the Peranakan mee, you know, Peranakan mee where we have the rojak, yeah, that actually also cannot be served for wedding. You know why? Because that is being served during funeral. What a family will probably offer to the guests, perhaps is mee siam. Yeah. But again, mee siam is not being offered during funerals. Yeah. So during happy occasions, the cakes and the food are different. And during ancestral worship, it's different. Yeah? But of course, Hong Teh is being served during Chinese New Year. Yeah, you know why? Because we have ancestral worship. And that's the food that we will eat for our reunion dinner. Yeah. Okay? So if there's no more questions, then I will end this sharing. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity.